Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. You've certainly heard the expression of Al-Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. And you've heard it here in England, in the America, and everywhere around the world, written on newspaper and preached on television. And that expression makes a lot of Muslims feel good about themselves. It gives them the feeling of superiority that their religion, their belief is actually conquering the world. And that deep inside them makes them feel like this must be a good sign that Al-Islam is the latest and the last best religion. But what's not said to us is that there is also a huge number of Muslims that are leaving Islam. Either these people have embraced Islam and now they are quitting Islam after a number of years, or Muslims that were born to Muslim parents and no longer are following the Islamic faith. And the question that we must raise and ask the question is, why is this happening? When people quit Islam, some of them, at least from the statistics of what I've read and heard and followed throughout the years, is that they become atheists. And the number of atheists has grown exponentially. And the greatest number of atheists in the Arab world is in Saudi Arabia, believe it or not. There are websites that promote atheism in the Arab world, and you have a whole website that's written in Arabic, and it's called Al-Mulhideen Al-Arab, the Arab Atheists. And I have subscribed to one of these sites, and I try to reason with people, and it is unbelievable to what depth people are really not believing and insulting Al-Islam. The Arabs are really, really strange in these things here. The amount of insults is unbelievable. And when you speak with them, they give you arguments and they point to sheikhs and they point to books and they point to these things and what these books speak about Al-Islam. And the sad news is 95% of what they say does exist out there. So we cannot just close an eye and they say, no, you've come up with these things. They actually have valid arguments because they exist in our books. Another portion of those born Muslims to parents Muslims have turned to Christianity. And one of the reasons as to why this happens is because now in the Arab world, there are dedicated non-Muslims, Christian channels that attack Islam exactly like Ahmed Didat did so many years ago. And I have already warned Muslims that the thing will backfire at us later on, because there were some Muslims, and I'm talking about 20 years ago, they wanted to learn what Ahmed Didat alayhi rahmatullah had, and they used to go to Hyde Park Corner here in England, and they would challenge and discuss and debate with Christians and try to prove to the Christian why they must abandon Christianity because of these contradictions that exist in Christianity. And they would report to them the different looks, the books, and John, and in John it says this, in Luke it says this, and look at the contradiction, and so on and so forth. Then came Zaki Naik, and he followed on the footsteps of Ahmed Didat. And alhamdulillah, and I say alhamdulillah, that now he is stopped from being to England and to many countries, because what he was doing, he was just pouring oil over an already burning brazier of fire. And the Christians now are doing exactly the same things. They will take a hadith or they will take an ayah and they bring with a contradictory statement between the scholars. And really, you listen to those Christian Arab channels or internet websites and you will doubt your Islam if you don't have a good anchor with Al-Quran. And I specifically mention Al-Quran, because the amount of contradictions that exist in the hadith, they will make you, i.e. the Christians, the Arab Christians from Lebanon, Egypt, and even Saudi Arabia. Now in Saudi Arabia, they have churches, house churches they call them, institution churches that they call them, but there are about 200 churches in Saudi Arabia, and the number of Christians is growing in Saudi Arabia to now, you won't believe it. This is why the current king of Saudi Arabia, Salman, when he went to Italy, he went and visited the Pope, and they had debates and things like that, because there are Christians, and the Pope wanted to speak to the king to guarantee the safeguard of those Christians that are in Saudi Arabia. Do not believe the hype of the so-called shuyukh, especially those so-called Salafi sheikhs. Well, as I said before, those Salafi sheikhs are Wahhabis in disguise. So do not believe in them when they say, oh, there are none. Well, they exact, you exist. And don't you believe me? Just go on YouTube and just type churches in Saudi Arabia, and you will get their priests, monks, vicars, and archbishops, and even they will give you details of the names and places and addresses in Saudi Arabia should you want to go and practice your Christianity in Saudi Arabia. So, when you hear the expression, Islam is the greatest or the fastest religion growing in the West here or in the world, and that makes you feel good, think about the huge number of those people, Muslims, that are quitting Islam. On YouTube, there are channels that promote, we have left Islam, what are you waiting for? And they will play a whole hour videos of sheikhs and the fatwa and everything, and believe me, if your faith is shaky, you don't want to go there, because it will shake you to the core. And again, the attacks are not from the Qur'an side, but it more so is from the state of the hadith and the sayings of the scholars, especially the nowadays scholars, and especially in Saudi Arabia. So this is from Christianity point of view, atheism point of view. Now, the other point where a lot of Muslims are becoming and turning to is Shi'ism. Shia, a lot of people are becoming Shia. And I am speaking here from Morocco all the way to Saudi Arabia. There is a huge propaganda from the Salafi school of thought. And that, what I mean by that, is the Saudi Arabian school of thought, which is nothing else but Wahhabism disguised as Salafism. And since long ago, they declared animosity against Iran. And since Iran is the adopter of Shi'ism, so it is a political fight between the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and the Republic of Iran. I'm not going to go here into historical why this is happening, as I will cover this, inshallah, in the series about the Shia and the Sunnah. But the reason I brought this one today is to make you realize that lots of Muslims worldwide are turning to Shi'ism. What is making them go to Shi'ism after all these years of being a Sunni? Well, as it turns out, my dear sisters and my brothers, the Shia these days have dedicated channels in Arabic. And these channels, they have scholars of the Shia. But these scholars are not only versed, knowledgeable about Shia school of thought. They are extremely, extremely well versed about the Sunni school of thought, far more than any other Sunni scholar existing today. When you look on our satellite channels, when we Muslims or the Sunnis speak against the Shia, we always say, for example, that the Shia say that the Quran has been falsified. Now, the scholars in the Shia world are calling on the Sunnis people. They say, instead of you just throwing accusations like that, bring evidences, and we are here to let you know that you are lying. And as it turns out, so many things that our school of thoughts, the Salafi school of thought, are accusing the Shia of are actually not true. But on the other hand, when the Shia want to establish one of their beliefs, guess what they do? They bring our own books of Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, Ibn Kathir, the Hadith Bukhari, Muslim, and all these things, and they establish their belief. And then Muslims, like the Sunni people, they start saying, hang on, these scholars of the Shia are using our textbooks to evidence what they believe in is the truth. And this is one of the ways that Muslims are moving to Shi'ism. Number two, so many historical facts that have been hidden from us, the Sunni world, and that these facts, they actually exist in all the major books of our scholars, from the books of Hadith to Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah to Ibn Taymiyyah to all the great scholars in the world, in the Sunni world. And these historical facts, they actually are in favor of what the Shia are calling for, especially when it comes into the whole tribulation, the problems that took place between Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah. In the Sunni world, whenever you want to know about what happened, you will find the Salafi school of thought, the Wahhabi school of thought, and also all those great scholars of the past, they tell you, we do not speak about what took place between the Sahaba, and we should just fold that part of history and move on. And that's what they did. And that's until today, the Salafi world does not, or the Sunni world does not speak about what happened between Ali and Muawiyah. They don't speak at all. Even about the murdering of Uthman, they don't speak about that at all. On the other side, every Shia out there is extremely well versed about what happened between the Sahaba. And then we have two different types of Muslims. The Sunni world completely ignoring what happened between the Sahaba and why they killed each other and why they fought. And why Aisha, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, used to hate Ali. And this is not in the books of the Shia, this is in our books of the Sunnah, in Bukhari, Muslim, and all these things. And that because of our mother Aisha, 10,000 Muslims, companions, and others were murdered in a battlefield between Ali and Muawiyah. And the reason for that is our mother Aisha. Why our Sunni scholars do not tell us these things is because they have a belief deep inside them that if they told us these things, we start hating our mother Aisha. And this is not true. But they kept us in the dark about these historical facts, and today the Shia are bringing those historical things, incidents and wars, and not only are they bringing them out to light, but they are mentioning them from our sources, from the Sunni sources. So here I am today, I'm just giving an example here. You take a Sunni regular day-to-day Muslim who had an idea because of the brainwashing of our Sunni scholars that the Shia are evil, they are this and they are this and they are this. So that person there or that woman there formulates an idea that vile about the Shia that they can't even stand the word Shia. They can't even stand hearing it. And suddenly a scholar from the Shia world who uses Arabic extremely well and also is very well versed both in his school of thought, the Shi'ism, and in our school of thought, the Sunnis, and he uses the argument from our own books. He hardly talks something from out of himself, but he speaks always what our scholars say to prove that the Shia are right. And tons of people are converting to Shia every day, a huge number. Even so much so today, in the political turmoil that's happening in Saudi Arabia, and how the Saudi government is leaning towards America, how the Saudi government runs to England to protect the throne and to America. And one at the same time, the whole world, America and England, are against Iran. A lot of people that used to be from the Sunni world that became Shia or became Shia sympathizers, what they are doing now, they are 100% supporting Iran, and they feel that the Western and Saudi Arabia have become a villain. They are especially Saudi Arabia. And also, my dear sisters and my brothers, one of the reasons as to why a lot of people are turning to Shi'ism is because of the betrayal of the religious institution in Saudi Arabia, and that this religious institution has always been a tool in the hands of the monarchy, in the kingdom of the kings of Saudi Arabia, to protect their throne. And because of that, our scholars, the Sunni scholars, for example, they issue fatwas that it is haram to revolt against the ruler. It is haram to criticize. It is haram to make a march. It is haram and it is haram. And they turned their own people in Saudi Arabia, and then they exported their disease to the world so that Muslims cannot call for their human basic rights. So what that has created is people started hating the Salafi religious institution. And the Shia, on the other hand, came to fill this gap and let people know that actually they have a right to have marches. They have a right to call to revolt. They have, just like Iran did it. When Al-Khomeini had his revolution at the end of the 70s, and he overthrew the Shah of Iran, and then the Islamic revolution in Iran took place, the Saudi government took the complete opposite way of injecting the Salafi people or the Sunni world with an injection call. You cannot, it is haram to revolt against your king. So he, and then it became a matter of political control. So a lot of people today are disillusioned with the way Saudi has run Islam. A lot of Muslims are so disillusioned with the Wahhabi institution, and also are disillusioned with the loftiness and how the Saudi people think of themselves as big shots. And now the different institutions, Christian Arab institutions, Shia institutions, and even Jewish Arab institutions are going deep into our books, and they are digging out a lot of dirt that the scholars of Islam have written. For example, in Egypt, al-fiqh ala al-madhahib al-arba'a, the fiqh on the based on the four school of thought, meaning you take something, let's say wudu, and then you see the four school of thoughts, what do they say about these things there, and you have four different points of view that are completely different, even though Allah in the Quran only spoke about the wudu in an ayah about 3-4 lines, nothing more. But the school of thoughts, not only have they differed about the wudu, but they launched a war against each other. Each one of them says that my way is the correct, their way is not the correct. So what, for example, the Shia are doing, and what the other denomination of Christians and even intellectuals, those people that do not want to subscribe to the Salafi or any organized Islamic religion. They started bringing all those, oh my God, the sore thumbs of what the scholars have said. And I'll give you an example. And this is now in Egypt, widely spread throughout Egypt. Guess what? This one, for example, in Sahih Muslim, and also part of it is scattered in different books of hadith, and this hadith is 100% as per the Sunni, our way, when we speak about this hadith, they say it's 100% authentic, that it's 100%. What does this hadith is what they call in Arabic Rada'atul Kabir, is the breastfeeding of an adult. And they claim that our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever she liked a person, a young man, for example, yeah, that's what they say. This is in our book, sadly. Whenever our mother Aisha sees a man that she likes him, and she wants not to be close, but she wants him to have a relationship with him as in friendliness, friendship, and she wants to be close to that person. What she would do, she would order her siblings to breastfeed that old man. This old man could be 29, could be 54, could be 52, could be whatever. And once that man is breastfed from that person there, who is the sister of Aisha, guess what happens then? Aisha becomes his khala, his maternal auntie. And as such, because the Qur'an prohibits the marriage, and then that man there would enter upon our mother Aisha, and he would see her, and she doesn't have to wear the hijab in front of him. This is in our books of hadith. Now the Christians and the Shia and everyone else is bringing this. So, and our scholars, they say the breastfeeding of adult is an act of sunnah. Now, you know what that means, my sister and my brother? You, my brother, you like a friend of yours, so you have your wife or your sister breastfeed that old man. And that's it. This is in our books of fiqh. And now these things are brought out. And I give you another example. They also have, we have in our fiqh, that if a man's wife becomes sick, it is not his responsibility to take her to a doctor, nor it is his responsibility to pay her medical bills. And they say, why? And this is in our books of fiqh. They say, because for him to spend money on her, he must be in the capacity to enjoy her sexually. So because when she is sick, he cannot enjoy her sexually, as such, he doesn't have to spend anything on her. So much so that in our fiqh they say, when a wife dies, a husband is not obliged to buy her not a coffin, not even a piece of cloth to wrap her in, because by her death, he becomes not a mahram for her. She becomes a complete stranger for her, because when she dies, the act of marriage has ended, has broken, and because of that, she is not his wife. She becomes just like an external person. These things are brought out in the light today. They will bring you issues. For example, when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the first Khalifa after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he launched the wars against the tribes, and he would win the war, he would take the wives of these fighters, and he would treat them as prisoners of war. And then he would just split them like a loot. That's it. That's what he got from the war. And he takes them as sabaya, prisoners of war. And he will treat them as such. He will divide them. That means they don't belong to their husbands at all. That's the end of it. When Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu died, when Umar ibn al-Khattab came, he abolished that. And he said that what Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did was wrong, and that women of these kind of fighters are still Muslims, and we cannot split them between the fighters and they become slaves. She's a Muslim, but she becomes a slave of another fighter. These things are coming, and I can mention you stories upon stories upon stories of what is being used today, so that Muslims leave the Sunni world and head to the Shia, head to Christianity, and head to atheism. Add to that all the haramization, all the things that the Salafi school of thought in Saudi Arabia has made haram on Muslims. Almost every single thing, over 500 things are haram that Allah has not made haram. Muslims today feel choked. They have the fingers, the hands, the grip of the iron hands of those scholars in Saudi Arabia that turned Islam into a set of forbidden laws. And Muslims are finding a way out, a breather into the Shi'ism. What took place between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah, even though every hadith that you read out there prioritizes Ali, even though Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned so many authentic hadith that Ali will be fought by an oppressing group of Muslims, that is Muawiyah. But we today, the Muslims, the Sunni world, are 100% supporters of Muawiyah, just like it has been for the last 1400 years ago. The Shia, on the other hand, they use even our ahadith, our own ahadith from Bukhari, Muslim, from the great scholars, historical facts that are mentioned by Ibn al-Athir, Ibn Kathir, and so many things, to support the case of Ali. And even today, in the Muslim world, in the Sunni world, they still insult. The other day, I was on YouTube channel. I was reading something, doing a research. And then on a website, the Muslims, especially in the UK, are insulting the Shia, like insults, unbelievable insults. And he said, may Allah curse the Rafida. And I thought to myself, I wonder if this person really understands what the term Rafida means. It's being used and it's being said, but a lot of people don't know exactly what it means. And they curse the Shia, who are, even we like it or we don't like it, they are Muslims and they are believers. And in the, under God, under Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, as Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ, that the believers are but brothers. And Allah said in the Quran Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, لَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, do not praise and do not give yourselves good attributes and title, because it is Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala هو أعلم بمن اتقى. It is only Allah that knows who truly is pious. What we know today about the Shia is what Ibn Taymiyyah wrote about the Shia and the attacks he launched against the Shia. So much so that the Sunni world will wrongly believe that if a Shia slaughters an animal, it is haram to eat from that animal, even if the Shia said Bismillah, Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, this is strange. In, of the fatwa, they say that a Sunni, it is haram for him to marry a girl from the Shia. Why? They say because they are Majus, they are pagans, they worship fires. Subhanallah. And today, this the Shia, they worship Allah and they pray and they do. Do they have something wrong? Of course they do. Just like we, the Sunni people, have a lot of things that are wrong with our belief as well. Because we have, our scholars manipulated the text so that people hate the Shia without even asking. Let me give you an example. Have you ever heard of an incident called Ghadir Khum, the oasis of Khum? The Sunni world, 99% of us, totally ignore this absolutely incredible mutawatir, i.e. a huge group of Muslims from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam have reported this hadith, and this hadith is authentic. It's in Bukhari, in Muslim, in Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, and Nasa'i, and so much. Very briefly, because I will deal with this inshallah later on when I deal with the Shia issue, so that we get to know the other side of the world, the Shia, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day, after the last Hajj that he performed, within the last 100 days of his life, as he was coming back from Al-Madinah, he stopped in a place not very, from Mecca to Al-Madinah, he stopped in a place not very far from Mecca called Khum, this oasis of Khum. And it is in that place where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a pledge from the Sahaba, because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam awla bil mu'minina min anfusihim. Our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is our supporter. He was the first one we would turn to, and he has more authority over us than us on ourselves, as the Quran says. When Rasulullah took the vow and the pact from the companions, that isn't that his status? And the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, yes, that is your status. You have more priority over ourselves than us, our families and everything. And then Rasulullah held the hand of Ali radiallahu anhu, and he rose it in the sky, rose it up, and he said, whomever I am his wali, whomever I am his priority, his supporter, the one who takes care, everything to him, then Ali is also his wali. The Shia have been barking about the authenticity of this hadith for so long. The Sunni world, we hide in this hadith, and the reason we hide in it, because our scholars are scared of, if they put this hadith forward, then we are aligning. We have become allied with the Shia. And as such, so many things that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said that are in favor of Ali are hidden today. Let me tell you something. Do you know that there are over 200 authentic ahadith that speak about the greatness of Ali and all the great attributes of Ali and all the beautiful things that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke about Ali? How many of hadith have you heard about Ali? Almost nothing. Because we are scared of saying anything about Ali today. Because if we say something about Ali, that's it, we become Shia. That's right, why people start pointing at you, you are Shia. When in fact, it is not. These are in our books, and these ahadith are authentic. To us Muslims, we hardly ever, Aisha radiallahu anha, our mother, was the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fatima is the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our world, of the Sunni world, we do not have any books that speak about a great relationship between Aisha and Fatima. Our mother Aisha didn't much get along with Fatima. And our mother Aisha didn't get much along with Ali radiallahu anha. This is why you don't hear of any hadith that is reported either from our mother Aisha, from Fatima, or from Fatima of Aisha, or from Ali and Aisha. You hear that, never ever you hear it. Because our mother Aisha, Ali rahmatullah radiallahu anha, had issues with the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his household. The Shia are well versed about this. The Sunni, they are hiding these things from us. So when the Shia bring these issues, and they bring the hadiths in Bukhari and Muslim and this and that authentic books, the Sunni world is shaken to the core. The Sunni world is shattered. How come the Sunni world becomes what? Doubtful of his scholars. They will say, what else have these Salafi scholars hidden from us? And why they did that to us? So my dear sisters and my brothers, a lot of our world today is hidden from us. And why I'm telling you this? For example, let me take a couple of examples and I'll end this talk here. For example, Al-Imam An-Nasa'i, one of the writers of the book of the Sunan. I'm sure you've heard of him. They say this hadith is reported by An-Nasa'i, by Ibn Majah. An-Nasa'i is a great man. Do you know how An-Nasa'i was killed? He was murdered. By whom was he murdered? A great imam of hadith murdered. He went to Damascus. When he came to Damascus, he saw the Muslims in Damascus. They hated the guts of Ali. And An-Nasa'i is a great imam of hadith. Not only is a great imam of hadith, but he is also a great scholar in the knowledge of man. The knowledge of man is he knows about guys who is authentic, who is not reliable, who is reliable, and that is very well needed in the science of hadith, to qualify and classify hadith as authentic or not. Biographies of man. When Al-Imam An-Nasa'i came to Damascus and he saw people insulting Ali, he was shocked. Why did you do that? He wrote, and so he wanted to promote the virtues of Ali radiallahu anhu, who is a member of household whom Allah has said to Rasulullah sallam, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا. Allah said to Rasulullah sallam to tell us, I do not ask any money, any reward, any recompense from you for me bringing Islam, إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, except that you be loving and you take care of the near ones to me. The hadith of Al-Kisa, the garment, 99% of Muslims don't know about it in the Sunni world, where one day Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the house of Fatima. And Fatima was with her son Al-Hassan and Al-Hussein. Now, notice as I speak about these things, you straight away, you relate to Shia. You start feeling something Shia is coming in, right? That's because how we have been programmed. Anything that speaks about Ali, Fatima, Al-Hassan, Al-Hussein is Shia. It's not. Rasulullah said, this hadith is in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, in every major book of hadith, you find this hadith, and it is authentic. Rasulullah said, he took Fatima, brought her near him, brought Al-Hassan near him, and Al-Hussein near him. And then he had a garment, and he was about to throw that garment over him. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, realized that Ali was behind him. Ali was just sitting there. And then Rasulullah ﷺ calls Ali, and Ali comes in. So I wanted to picture this. Rasulullah ﷺ sitting, Fatima near him, Ali near him, Al-Hassan and Al-Hussein, all of them close to Rasulullah ﷺ. So Rasulullah ﷺ took off that garment, and he put it over himself. He pulled it over himself because he was behind his back. And then he pulled it, and he covered Fatima, and he covered Ali, and he covered Al-Hassan, and he covered Al-Hussein. He put them all under that, and he said to them that you are the members of my household. Umm Salama was close to that, one of his wives, and she wanted to put her head under that garment so to get the blessings. And then Rasulullah ﷺ stopped her from being or putting her head under that garment because he only wanted Ali, Fatima, Al-Hassan and Al-Hussein. Just look at yourself. You've never, maybe you've read it. Maybe you've never heard of these things. But to every Shia out there, they know this hadith just like you know your mother and your father, or you know your kids and you know everyone around you. So my dear sisters, Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i, he wrote a book where he mentioned 200 authentic hadith about the virtues of Ali radiallahu anha. When the people of Asham, so Syria, saw that to him, and they said, 200, that's way too much. And because they were 100% pro Muawiyah, the Umayyad household, the dynasty of Muawiyah, they asked him, why don't you write something about Muawiyah? And Nasa'i alayhi rahmatullah, what a great man he was, he said, what do I know about Muawiyah? Except la ashba'a Allahu batna, may he never ever find satisfaction when he eats, like he never gets full. And that is because one day, and this hadith again is in Bukhari, in Muslim books, authentic books of hadith. One day Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for your information, Muawiyah embraced Islam at the end of his life. It was not something like, it was not like the other people that were close. But anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted him to write a letter to some person. He sent a kid to call Muawiyah. Muawiyah was eating. So the child tells him, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam calls you. What do you think Muawiyah did? As Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu istajibu lillahi wa lirrasul idha da'akum lima yuhyikum. You who believe, whenever Allah or his messenger call you to him, or Rasulullah calls you to him, go to him so that whatever he calls you for will revive you. So when the kid came to Muawiyah and he told him Rasulullah wants you, what did Muawiyah said? He said, I am eating. Would you believe it? Rasulullah calls him and he says, I am eating. So the kid goes back to Rasulullah and he tells him what happened. Rasulullah tells him one more time, go and call him. The kid goes back the second time. Muawiyah answers the same thing. I am eating. Let him wait. Subhanallah, this is. And then for the third time, Rasulullah sends the kid, and Muawiyah for the third time tells the kid, I am eating. He would not leave his food and go to respond to Rasulullah. What if Rasulullah, I don't know, was going to be killed or something was dangerous, major was going to happen. But he didn't care. And on the third time, Rasulullah said to him, La ashba'a Allahu batna. May Allah never make Muawiyah feel full from when he eats. And after that day, Muawiyah never ever felt full from the food he eats. So when An-Nasa'i told him, this is the only authentic hadith that is about Muawiyah. And for your information, anything else that is said about Muawiyah is a lie. It's because they wanted to counter. Ali has got these virtues, they wanted to write, even so much so that they fabricated a hadith that if someone doesn't believe that Muawiyah is the leader of the mu'mins and thing, and he is a believer, will is not a believer. And this is all nonsense. Back to An-Nasa'i. When An-Nasa'i told them, I only know that hadith about his eating, you know what the people did? They beat An-Nasa'i until they killed him. Because they say An-Nasa'i was mutashayya, but it was not. He was not Shia. He just loved the house of the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you look in our books of hadith, when they say X Y Z is a Shia of like An-Nasa'i, for example, yeah, just Al-Hakim al-Nisaburi. Al-Hakim is the guy. Today you've heard it reported by Al-Hakim, narrated by Al-Hakim, right? Well, Al-Hakim was beaten until almost to death. Because also for the same thing for Ali radiallahu anha. This is why today we cannot, the Shia are well versed about these things. The Sunni world hides them. Because the truth of the matter is, as I said it once before, the Shia got it right historically. We got it right believably. So we've got some things, they made mistakes in some of their beliefs. Alhamdulillah, today we are far better off than what they are, even though the books of before also have problems, just like the Shia. And it's not just about worshipping a grave or things like that. So a lot of Muslims these days, because of the satellite TVs and because of the YouTube and all these things, a lot of the Sunni world are shaken to the core. And they're discovering that at the end of the day, Ali radiallahu was done injustice, was murdered, was killed. Al-Hasan radiallahu anha, who is the grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was murdered with poison. Al-Husayn violently murdered, his head decapitated. Ali radiallahu anha, killed. So when you get all these issues, and the Sunni world, our scholars hide them from us. So what do you think the world, the Sunni world, when they discover the truth, they went to Shi'ism. And it doesn't matter how much we insult the Shia every single day, we can insult them 100 times. The truth of the matter is, those ahadith that they base their belief on, especially historically, exist in our books of hadith, and you will see those things, inshallah, when I start dealing with the Shia. So this also has pushed our scholars, the Sunni scholars, what? They started crying wolves. Oh, the Shia, they are expanding, they are here, and they are dominating everywhere they go. Iran starts converting people to Shi'ism, wherever they do. Guess what? Iran doesn't need to do these things, because television, YouTube, streaming, and all those live websites and things like that, by just mentioning the ahadith that exist in our books, a lot of Muslims are disillusioned and lost all hopes in the Sunni scholars, especially nowadays that we have Christians, Arab-speaking scholars, we have Shia Arabic-speaking scholars, we have Jewish Arabic-speaking scholars. What they do, they take what the Sunni scholars say and the contradictions, and they have, and believe me, you go there in the Arabic, how it's promoted, you would easily lose faith. Wallahi al-azim, you would easily lose faith. This is why sticking by Al-Quran is the 100% guarantee, and not only reciting it, it never gets beyond your throat. Really spending time pondering on the Quran, taking the laws of Al-Quran. Our Sunni world, we say that the Quran is valid for all time, all places, all over the world, anywhere. You've heard this expression, right? Well, guess what? What they truly mean is this. They truly mean is this. Anyone who embraces Islam must adopt the Wahhabi Salafi way of thinking and follow their path. In other words, if the entire world embraced Islam today, they have to become Saudi-like. Women have to cover themselves, and that's it. Wouldn't you believe it that in our Sunni world, the oppression and transgression of the government is halal? Wallahi, there are tons of ahadith that give upper hand to the iron grip of the ruler, even if he takes your money, hits you, and does whatever, you have to obey him. It means democracy, salam alaikum. If England embraced Islam, England will become nothing else but a small town in Saudi Arabia. And you know how the kingdom of Saudi Arabia rules Islam. In Saudi Arabia, there are about 3 million to between 3 to 5 million Shia people. And they live in the eastern parts of Al-Qasim Al-Ihsa of Saudi Arabia. These places are extremely rich in crude oil. Tons of millions. These are the poorest places on earth. Human rights in Saudi Arabia, assalamu alaikum. Is this the name in the name of Islam? They have La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah on their flag, and the weakest, most evil place on earth where you can be a human is Saudi Arabia. No human rights at all. Nothing at all. You go there, they are so arrogant. Look at how they treat the people that work there. These days, Saudis are recording. You see, in England, when we received this letter about threatening to Muslims, we all got panicky and things like that. In Saudi Arabia, there are people in Saudi Arabia that record live streams and feeds of videos, and they are going around in Saudi Arabia. They told Yemenis, Egyptians, and any other person from different parts of the Muslim world that is working in Saudi Arabia to either quit Saudi Arabia or they will be slaughtered like pigs. And this is a Muslim talking about a Muslim. Why is it then when an English person says it about us, we get all jittery and all these problems, when Saudi Arabia in the name of Islam is doing that to people? My dear sisters and my brothers, these are the reasons, or some of the reasons, as to why a huge number of Muslims are quitting Islam altogether. A huge number of Muslims are going atheist, or becoming Christians, or becoming Shia. And you have two ways of dealing with this. It's either you educate yourself properly and your children about what Allah put in Qur'an first. Now, there is no such thing like Al-Fawzan is a companion that has just escaped time. He should have been a companion. Al-Fawzan is not a companion. He is a man with an agenda, and he works for the Saudi government. And so does the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia, and so does the Grand Mufti of Egypt, and so do so many Grand Muftis of so many different organizations that claim to be working for Allah as preachers and things like that. My dear sister, you have to educate your children, you have to set them free, you have to let them discover for themselves, help them with the Quran, not just memorizing the Quran and that's it. No, teach them to really understand the message of Allah. Because if you don't want your child one day to turn Christian or atheist or a Shia, then you want to educate them properly, and don't you ever forget to educate them about the greatness and the majestuosity of the household of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is Ali radiallahu anha, Fatima radiallahu anha, Al-Hasan and Al-Hussein, that the other members of the household like Al-Abbas and Abdullah ibn Abbas and other the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because if you don't do it, one day your child will be surprised, taken by surprise, and it will shake him or her to the core, and Islam would become absolutely not a thing just like it is today. So please, 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 please pay attention. Shia are not our enemies. It's the Saudi Arabia propaganda machine that has turned them into vile enemies. They call them a Rafida, just to close my talk here. The Rafida is the one who does not accept. What haven't they accepted? They do not accept that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq or Umar ibn al-Khattab, that their leadership, they refuse their leadership. They say, because of the ahadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave priority to Ali, and that his leadership was taken away by Abu Bakr Siddiq and Umar. Even though this is a historical fact and it's gone. I accept, I don't accept, I change absolutely nothing. But it is more on how they support Ali. Are they correct in doing this? Of course not. Of course not, because it just creates animosity and all the hate between Muslims. But also from our end, we must not deny the great rights of Ali. Just because the Shia are pro-Ali, we must be anti-Ali. This is not the way it functions. I pray to Allah that this will open your eyes to what we are going through. And I pray to Allah to keep us closer to Al-Quran until we go back to Allah with Al-Quran. By this, I also mean that the Sunnah is authentic. But when I get into the series about the Hadith, I will explain to you what's the difference between the Sunnah and the Hadith, and why the Sunnah is acceptable and we must honor the Sunnah. And as for the Hadith, there is a completely different view. I will discuss this, inshallah, when I speak about the science of Hadith and how we can interact with that. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. My telephone number, if you want to join me on my WhatsApp group, is 078-76-40-87-35. This talk and so many other talks can be also found on my YouTube channel, and that is Islam Pep Talk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.